For years, Valve has been secretly funding a small army of developers with a big goal: to replace Windows. Now, you probably saw the recent announcement of the Steam Machine along with the Steam Frame and a brand new controller, but you could have easily missed something important. The Frame runs on an ARM processor, just like the one in your phone. How, you might ask, did they get Windows games to run on the same chip out of a Galaxy S24? I mean, that should be impossible, right? The whole reason I wanted to make this video is that the other day I was reading what seemed like a pretty normal interview that The Verge did with Pierre Liu, one of Valve's architects behind SteamOS and the Steam Deck. The more I read this interview though, the more I was legitimately shocked at some of the casual mentions he was just dropping. Like, what? Excuse me? A key piece of this is FEX, a translator designed to turn instructions meant for AMD or Intel CPUs into something that mobile ARM chips can process. Now, I've been vaguely aware of this project. We've seen it bubble up a couple times over the last year especially, but I had no idea that Valve didn't just support FEX. It was their idea. They have been funding the developers of FEX since the beginning back in 2018. That is 7 years of quietly paying open source developers to solve a problem that most people didn't even know existed. Now, Microsoft has an enormous team building Windows on ARM, and here, Valve are paying open source enthusiasts to build their own version. This was kind of crazy to me. I mean, I knew that Valve helped contribute to a lot of projects that ultimately made things like SteamOS possible, but when I really started going down the rabbit hole, holy sh**. Back in 2022, a few months after the Steam Deck was released, Valve told The Verge that they were already funding over 100 open source developers. Who knows how many they're working with at this point. And these aren't Valve employees. They are incredibly smart and passionate devs from all around the world working on very specific problems. Maybe someone's working on graphics drivers for AMD GPUs, someone's working on DirectX translation, someone's working on CPU emulation. Like, you get the idea. And this code, it is open source. That means that anyone can use it, anyone can contribute to it, and anyone can build on top of it. It means that the entire Linux gaming community is testing their code, filing bug reports, and submitting patches. They're getting thousands of hours of QA for free. And while everyone benefits from these improvements, Valve control the platform. They are not locking people into Windows. They're establishing their stack, and therefore Steam, as the standard. All of this because Valve saw an existential threat from Microsoft over a decade ago, and instead of just reacting to it like a normal company would, they spent years building the tool to make Windows optional and maybe even irrelevant. Before I explain how all this works, let me just show you, because this tech, it's not theoretical. It exists right now and you can try it for yourself. So this is the Red Magic 11 Pro. It's an Android gaming phone with the latest Snapdragon 8 Gen 5 processor, and I'm going to run a full Windows Steam game on it. Now, this phone is serious business. It has an actual water cooling loop as well as an active fan, which I'm sure you can hear. This thing is quite powerful in all the good and the bad ways, but we wanted to use this to kind of give this the best possible shot because what we're taking advantage of right now is an app called Game Hub. Now, it is using FEX on the back end, right? Which of course is an open source project. We're gonna talk a lot about sort of how that all works. But I just wanna be clear that this is not the Valve certified version of this whole process, right? This is something that a third party has built. It is running on Android, not SteamOS, which will theoretically give more performance benefits. It will be much more optimized. But I wanted to show you what happens when I load an actual game from my real Steam library on my phone. Let's see here. I'm gonna do the low preset, everything off. I want this to look like the Switch 1 version. This is The Witcher 3. It is not a super smooth experience. So if you look on the bottom left corner, you'll see that I'm getting notionally 40 to 50 FPS. However, there's quite a lot of sort of input latency as well as there's definitely some hitching. As you can see here, it's not the smooth experience even though theoretically we're playing this at 50 FPS. But I just really want to emphasize, this is a full Windows game designed for NVIDIA and AMD GPUs that is running inside of an Android app. The amount of translation, the amount of graphic support, the amount of things you need to do as it crashes to make something like this work is really tremendous. I'm gonna not play that again. Why don't we play a different game? One of the games that we've tried that is probably one of the most well-sorted is Stray. So again, we're loading it from Steam. So this is connected to my actual Steam account, which I will say you may want to be a little careful giving random third-party apps access to your Steam account, but for purposes of this, we're gonna give it a shot. Oh, we're here, we're in. Like, this looks actually really good. Hello. Doop-a-doop-a-doop-a-doop. I won't eat anyone, don't worry. I'm a very dangerous cat.
Meow.
So this is a Windows x86 game running on an Android phone with an ARM processor. Like, I want to be clear, it's janky, but it fundamentally works. Imagine how this will be on actual SteamOS hardware. Let me show you what Valve actually built, because when I say they replaced Windows, I mean they replaced everything to do with Windows. So let's start up here at the top with the operating system. Windows has been around since the 80s, and what SteamOS really is based on Linux. So Linux is a free and open source operating system, and that is, in a lot of ways, actually kind of the simple part, right? There are lots and lots of Linux distributions. What makes SteamOS special is all the other stuff that they've built underneath that. This brings us to Proton. So this, if you've used a Steam Deck, is something you've probably heard about. This is based on an older piece of tech called Wine. It really just comes from back in the old Linux days where people were frustrated that Windows apps weren't being ported to Linux. So like, hey, what if we just made a middleman to help trick apps and now games into thinking that it's still running on Windows when you're in fact running on Linux? So essentially, every time the game calls for something to say, hey, go out to the storage and get me this, what replaces all the Windowsy code with something that is natively supported on Linux. It's really clever. It has taken years to get to this point, but it has gotten incredibly good. This is why Steam Deck games run so well right out of the box, even though pretty much every game you play on a Steam Deck just thinks it's a Windows game, because it is a Windows game. There's just no Windows involved. Next, we have graphics. So this is where DirectX comes in. So DirectX is Microsoft's proprietary graphics API. The reason this is important is that it standardizes everything. So if you're a developer making Halo, you don't have to make your Halo game for NVIDIA PCs and AMD PCs and Intel PCs. As long as you're making it to the DirectX standard, it should be pretty much universal. It might not surprise you to know that there is no DirectX for Linux, which is why Valve have helped to create a number of different things, including DXVK as well as VKD3D. These all run to the Vulkan runtime. It's a long story, but basically the same way that Proton sort of tricks the Windows APIs into actually thinking that it's a Windows PC when it's really running on SteamOS, that's kind of what these things are doing as well, right? So it's translating all those instructions that the game is expecting to go to DirectX, and it's actually going into a much more Linux-friendly form. Basically, you could sum this whole chart into everything thinks it's Windows, and nothing is actually Windows. It's all a layer of lies, deception, and somehow it actually works. Now you might be wondering, why? Why spend over a decade building all of this? Well, the answer goes back to 2012 and a fundamental threat that Valve saw coming. It was a very different time. Windows 8 had just launched, and it was controversial. Not only had Microsoft heavily rebuilt the excellent Windows 7 to be more friendly for tablets, even if you had a giant desktop display, but they also introduced the Windows Store. Now, this is the first time that Microsoft had ever built an app store directly into Windows. They also began pushing this thing called the Universal Windows Platform, basically laying the groundwork to make Windows work like iOS, where all apps would go through their store. Gabe Newell, Valve's co-founder, did not f around. He called Windows 8, quote, a catastrophe for everyone in the PC space. Valve was pretty much entirely reliant on Steam running on Windows. So if Microsoft did decide to lock things down, Valve's business would have been crushed essentially overnight. So they started building a backup plan. In 2013, just a few months after Gaben started sounding the alarm bells publicly, Valve announced SteamOS and Steam Machines. The pitch was simple. Linux-based gaming devices that didn't need Windows at all. By 2014, progress had been made, but fast forward to 2015 when Steam Machines were actually ready to launch, and it was a disaster. They were expensive, and unlike SteamOS of today, they did not support Windows games back then. Every game had to be ported specifically to Linux, which meant that the library was tiny. And frankly, no one really understood what the point of a Steam Machine actually was. So, when Microsoft backed off the idea of a walled garden with Windows 10, crisis averted, right? But Valve kept building. And here's the most valuable lesson they learned with the failure of the first Steam Machines. You can't ask developers to do extra work. they're just not going to port their games to Linux or recompile them for ARM. I mean, the market is just too small, the effort is too high, and it just is not worth it for a market that isn't proven. So Valve made an incredibly smart call on hindsight. If you can't ask developers to do the extra work, you can just do it for them. Now to do this, they had to build the tools to replace Windows from the ground up, so game doesn't even realize that it's not running on a traditional gaming PC. You know, just rebuild decades of work and the fundamentals of what makes a computer a computer. No big deal. Valve weren't just building an alternative, they were building insurance. Fast forward to today, and Valve's long-term bets are finally paying off. And guess what? Microsoft is waking up. Recently, they published this blog post highlighting what they've done for PC gaming in 2025 and some plans for the future. Now, there's good stuff here, continuing to optimize Windows for handhelds and presumably consoles, improving ARM support, DirectX advances. I mean, it all sounds familiar, right? If you saw a review of the ROG Xbox Ally, you'll know that while there's promise, Windows is still far from where it needs to be on handheld. Games don't properly sleep or resume, you're dealing with multiple storefronts, fractioned driver updates, and you still have to rely on a Windows desktop sometimes on your 7-inch screen. Meanwhile, SteamOS on the Steam Deck, it feels just like a console. And it works. Games sleep and resume reliably, updates are seamless. It is just a better experience than Windows, which is kind of embarrassing. And I think Microsoft know it. I've had conversations with people inside of Microsoft, and I do know that they're spending a lot of time and effort on overhauling Windows, not only for the Xbox Ally, but likely for the next-gen Xbox, which would be way more of a PC than any console they shipped before. And I want to be clear, this is great. Competition makes everyone better. We all win here, with Valve making legitimately excellent options to game on, and Microsoft trying to turn Xbox into something really different than anything we've seen before. But I've got to admit, I missed the last piece of the puzzle. I have to say, I slightly question how seriously are Valve really going to be able to take bringing SteamOS to third parties. Now I say this with nothing but love for what they've done. I mean, the Steam Deck is the way I play games these days. Sure, having my Steam library largely just work out of the box is a big part of it, but the way that, in my opinion, they've gotten traction so far is because they have straight up made a better product. When Valve first announced that they were bringing SteamOS to third-party hardware, I was like, can they actually support this? I mean, Valve has 350 employees versus Microsoft's 228,000. I mean, how could they possibly hope to compete? But here's where I was wrong. Microsoft has a massive legacy Windows code base that goes back decades, not to mention layers of management. I mean, like, gaming is always going to be a small consideration of the overall Windows story. Valve has a singular focus, games. They have a small core team, a significant bench of open source developers, and no shareholders demanding short-term profits. Look, most companies would have killed SteamOS after Steam Machines flopped in 2015. At that point, there was no clear path forward, and with Microsoft backing off the walled garden, crisis averted, time to move on. But Valve kept investing, kept building, which eventually led to the success of the Steam Deck and beyond. So what happens next? I think optimizing Steam games for ARM makes a lot of sense on the frame. Let's not forget, this is first and foremost meant to stream games from your PC, and it just so happens to play some stuff natively. It is a super low stakes way to test tech-like effects in a way that no one will be that upset if the game is just a little bit buggy for now. But there's no reason it stops there. An ARM-powered Steam Deck that takes advantage of all the compatibility work from the frame, with a smaller and lighter chassis and way better battery life, yeah, that's probably coming. This is why I'm so excited about the future. Effects make so many things possible. Will we see the full version of Steam with all of your games on Android? A Steam phone? Maybe. I mean, why stop at replacing Windows when you could run Steam on, I mean, almost anything? Valve is doing amazing work, but it is a bad idea to count Microsoft out yet. When they get serious about something, they have the resources to make really cool stuff far beyond what we've seen with just something like the Xbox Ally. I mean, I would be genuinely surprised if Microsoft just let Valve have free rein in the gaming space. So yeah, it's a challenge. Your move, Microsoft. Now if you enjoyed this, definitely be sure to ring-a-ling that ding-a-ling and check out our video on the future of Xbox or what's going on with the Steam Machine. I'll be covering this story a whole lot more in the near future. It is truly, truly a wild time.